Hi, this is Steve Morse, and you're listening to Sonic Perspective.
Hey, this is Scott Medina for Sonic Perspectives, and we're really excited today to have Steve Morse on the line. Are you there, Steve?
Yes.
Thanks so much for taking a little time to talk with us.
Well, thanks for doing this.
Yeah, I'm looking at your itinerary right now, and I see you're just on a short break with the Dixie Dregs before you start up the tour again in April. So, yeah, I'm wondering how this run has been for you.
It's been great. In fact, we just played less than 12 hours ago. less than 24 hours ago.
Yeah, how's the reaction been from the audience?
Oh, it's been absolutely amazing. It's a life-changing event for a lot of people that are sort of revisiting that time in their lives from the new band. And there was a different sort of thing in the air about music. Coming to see us and not having heard this stuff in so long really brings it back and brings it alive to them. And to the young people that come, it's just like, what the heck? I didn't know there was music like this, because in reality, the conditions that made our band don't exist anymore. You know, you couldn't have the exact same influences as we had. And the economic conditions are such that bands like us wouldn't be formed any good in all likelihood.
Yeah, exactly. It really was a different time. So it's a treat to be revisiting in this way with the early lineup from the band.
But it's really cool for us, too, because, the audience, you could feel the warm vibe and the just sort of celebration atmosphere.
So I'm curious, with things like Andy West being back, his bass playing was such an integral part of the original Dregs sound and feel. Can you talk what it's like to have Andy back in the band playing bass after all these years?
Well, it's crazy, because when we got together for a trial session before, we committed to doing any kind of a tour. And during that time, when we did get together, everybody seemed like they were just the exact same people. they looked the same, the voices the same, the reaction to things the same, and they're playing the same. It was uncanny how it was like somebody just did a 40-year wave at
you. Wow.
And Andy was a big part of the philosophy of the band and the decision-making of how we did things. So it's more than just his playing that makes it seem like old time.
Wow. Well, what a credit to all of you that you can kind of pick up where you were 40 years earlier and just continue on and have a great time with it.
Yeah, well, everybody had a lot of homework to do on this one, because we did a lot of stuff that not everyone had played. Like DJ Rowski's having learned the songs from after he was in the band. But, we're obviously doing all the stuff that we can from the early days that he played.
And does your own approach to playing, does that change if you're playing with Andy versus with Dave LaRue?
No, I think the song choices might change a little bit. So in all cases, I try to write or work with the people that I have, and work to their strengths. And so, Andy's parts obviously felt more authentic than anybody else, because he had a really unique style of playing, and, playing with a pick. Mm-hmm. And it's just a natural fit. And with Dave was more a super strong soloist, and, he had a finger style, which was better for like funky things, or he could work with a lot of a different kind of intricate guitar part.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said, was a super strong soloist. So we have, and drum wise, the animal main from my trio still is very strong drummer with a multitude of styles, and Rod just is like a conductor. He emotes the entire song composition with drums. He plays it as a musical instrument that just happens to be a drum.
Yeah. Would you share with us a little bit about what goes on inside of you while you're playing for an audience? Like, what's your internal experience like?
Oh, a lot of things. Yeah, obviously, there's cues, things to watch out for, things to switch, and I'm going through this whole thing with my technique. I'm changing from holding the three fingers and the thumb and twisting my wrist in two axes to playing with a stiff wrist. And it's because I've got felt some arthritis in my right wrist. It's very painful to play the old way.
Yeah.
And so now I'm trying to minimize the time I play with the old way and increase the time that I play with the new way. And so almost every moment that I play, I'm strategizing on when I'm going to shift the pick position. And during this tour, it sort of became an automatic thing. I just like switching pickups on my guitar. Mm-hmm. I just do it without thinking about it. And now it sort of got to that point now, which is kind of cool.
Yeah.
But I think, obviously thinking about sound and dynamics and what can we do is, and when I'm playing a solo, I just have to not plan. It's best if I don't plan anything. On a couple of solos, there are planned out parts that take us out and they're cues to the band. And those remain. But when it comes to the soloing part, you just have to just forget yourself and just trust that it's going to be okay. we encourage improvised solos that are different every night.
Yeah, so you just fly in there and then you... It's great you have both parts of the world there to just fly free in certain parts of the opera and then other parts you have to really stay focused and be thinking about the mechanics of everything going on.
Yeah, and for each solo there's a sound that you have to select and tailor. There might be a high gain or a low gain or a compressor, low gain, and there might be a little bit of delay you want to put on. So there's a lot of choices there. Tailoring the sound and then which pickup to use on the guitar. So there's thinking and choices made constantly in my house.
Yeah, I hear that. So after this next leg of the tour is done, you go right back out on the road with Deep Purple. How is that for you, switching gears with such different kinds of bands?
Well, it's all music and it's all tonal music and that's basically one big classification. And as long as I'm playing within that classification, there's no problem. It would be a problem if I had to look a certain way or act a certain way, but I don't. Both bands are cool with me just being myself and addressing the music. And in the process of addressing the music, I automatically am considering the audience. In fact, it may be considered them too much at times, but it is the main reason we're there.
Yeah. And what's it like then coming into more of a co-writing band like you do with Flying Colors, as opposed to writing for the Steve Morse Band where you have total control?
Well, in the old days, all throughout the classic era of Dregs, back up until the end, I could get the band to try any of my ideas. they had to like it before we would keep it, but we always tried. And if they didn't like it, I could come up with more. Whereas with Flying Colors or Canvas or Purple, I could usually get them to try my ideas, but there's a chance that, by the time we get into it, somebody could be complaining that it's not conducive to singing or this is too hard to sing over, followed by me saying, but just try. followed by them saying, wait, I got a different idea. Why don't we just play this? And then the other guys go, yeah, let's do that. So it's like trying to get a word in edgewise sometimes.
Yeah, so they don't always give it a fair try first, huh?
Well, they will if I push it.
Yeah.
If it doesn't seem to stick, and sometimes something at first try doesn't work, and I know deep down in my gut, this is a fantastic part. The band is perfect for the band, they're going to love it, but they just have to learn it because it's hard to do.
Mm-hmm.
And in those cases, I will just hammer and hammer away till I'm so annoying that they will give in and try to learn. And usually those are very successful.
Do you foresee having much time to get back to the third Flying Colors album in the upcoming year?
Upcoming year, I don't know, because no one can tell me what's happening after September. But I know up until there, and there's no telling. I mean, unless we had a really short session. I don't want to have a short session. I want the third album to be as good as the first two. And, you know, it takes time. It takes some time. And I don't like that there's a lot of pressure to get it done. And I think that, you know, band is just too special of a chemistry to have a stopwatch going.
Yeah, last month I was on the Cruise to the Edge, and Casey McPherson was doing a solo set, and Mike Portnoy and Neil Morse sat in with him, and, you know, you could just tell they were really taking a shine to being back together with him, and I just got that feeling of, like, there was some, even though everyone's involved with so many different projects, it felt like there was a real love for that band and for people playing together of those songs. They even performed Blue Ocean, which I hadn't heard them do before, so that... Yeah, hopefully the stars will align to get you all together for a good chunk of time.
Yeah, I hope so.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a great band. Great band.
Yeah. Where do you find your inspiration for songwriting comes from? Does it come like when you're out for a walk or waking up from a dream or flying solo in your plane? Or where does that come from?
I think it's just sort of hunger for expression. And, you know, when you're hungry for food, you can just sort of listen to cravings and say, you know, I'm craving this. You know, some people say I really want a salad or something, or I really want some heavy duty protein or probiotics. You know, people can sort of get in touch with what they need, and you can do the same thing with your creativity. You can just say, what am I trying to express, and you know, have it be very passionate. Very, very direct line to your soul. Okay. I'm not good words to describe the process, but to a certain extent, you can hear music in your head. The more experience you have with your instrument, the easier it becomes to create parts to duplicate that rambling answer.
Well, it's hard to put into words, you know, inspiration that comes into the form of music, you know, by its very definition there, so... Do you get to play classical guitar much these days?
Well, I'm doing it during our set now, during the Dregs set.
Right, right.
And although my classical guitar that I was using got stolen two weeks ago in D.C., which is a total bummer.
I know, I saw the news on that. Yeah.
But anyway, I've got it. We're still doing that segment, and that's very cool and very satisfying to have, you know, variety. Variety, I think, is essential to a concert. And, you know, the modern era doesn't bear me out on this, but I think that audiences can handle a lot more options than they're given.
When you're on your own, do you like playing, do you prefer playing electric or classical just for yourself?
And it totally depends. If there's an amp there and I can get a good sound by myself, I would like to play electric, but at the same time, you know, when I get tired of doing that, and I see there's my classical, I'll pick it up and play something with that. It's a little weird when you do it for a profession. The line's blurred between work and relaxation of playing your instrument. What I feel like is a tremendous amount of responsibility to my work to spend time with my instrument anyway. So it's usually when there's long breaks that I, you know, feel like I could just say this time is just for messing around. But I believe every musician should have time for messing around with it. It's included in the practice schedule.
Yeah, I agree. So just to wrap it up, I'm curious, knowing what you know now, what kind of wisdom do you think you would share with your younger self, say, as you were starting out to be a full-time musician? What wisdom would you want to pass on that really be most salient?
I would say, well, young self, you predicted correctly. The winds of popularity will certainly elude you. However, just be glad for every success you have, and remember that it comes from audiences being moved in a positive way. Everything comes from, and make that your goal at all times.
Well, you're certainly continuing to do that and move audiences in a very positive way. And I'm just so glad for everybody, audience, and you and the band alike, to have this opportunity to revisit the Dregs in this way. And hope you enjoy the second leg of the tour in April.
We will. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks for doing this, by the way.
Thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us, Steve.
Right. Excellent. Thank you.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for listening, everyone. And a big thanks to Steve Morse for taking the time to talk to us. Again, this is Scott Medina for Sonic Perspectives, and we hope you will like our pages on Facebook and Twitter and follow us for the upcoming reviews and interviews that we have coming down the pipeline here. We'll leave you with a track from the Dixie Dregs, going back to their Free Fall album, which they are touring right now for the original lineup from that album. This is Cruise Control.